Just as the Father has loved me, I have loved you. Now remain in my love. If you obey my commands, you will remain in my love. In the same way, I have obeyed my Father's commands and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy will be in you. I also want your joy to be complete. Here is my command. Love each other just as I have loved you. And from 1 John 4, 7 and 8 and 11 through 13. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us and his love is made complete in us. This is how we know that we live in him and he in us. He has given us of his Spirit. Well, the service today was prepared, written, printed off, everything by Jane, and I appreciate that. She's giving the same in Pawnee Rock that we're hearing here. What do you believe God wants for us? Now, think about this and answer it truthfully. What do you believe God wants for you? If we believe what we read in the scriptures, we know God wants total love and complete joy. I repeat, God wants us to live in utter joy and with complete love. Jesus told the disciples, as recorded in the Gospel of John, and what Jesus is saying to his disciples, he is saying to us, I love you. Remain in my love, or receive my love. And I want your joy to be complete. Do we believe this? Can we let ourselves truly believe the only thing God wants for us is to live in love and receive joy? Why is this so hard to believe? Because sometimes, or maybe most of the time, it doesn't seem that way. If we look out on the world today, it doesn't seem like the vast majority are living in utter love and full of joy. And we talked about that in Sunday school. If we look at our own lives and are completely honest, we do not live like we are completely full of love and corresponding joy. Or that this is what we're expecting out of life. And this is a paradox. We would like our lives to be full of love and utter joy. God wants us to experience a life of love and full of joy. But just because we want it, and God is giving it to us, doesn't mean we have it. What? Swedenborg reminds us, in order to feel full of joy and love, we need to become receivers of love and joy. Like in football. Sometimes we talk about being vessels to receive the love and joy, or receptacles, but it's the same thing as a receiver. Our goal in life is to be receivers of God's love and joy. We are to abide in God. This is not an overnight awareness. This is a lifelong journey, and we call it regeneration. We can call it our spiritual journey. Hopefully, we're headed in the right direction and are making progress. Like catching a football, it takes practice. Sometimes we think we should just know how to find and experience joy. But really, we don't automatically know how to catch joy. Sometimes things that have happened in our lives block that joy. Sometimes we do things unintentionally that block our ability to receive. Sometimes we just don't find the joy. We need to examine our lives and learn what blocks joy for us. One way to start is with the lessons in the scripture for today. Jesus reminds us in these verses, I have obeyed my Father's commands and remain in his love. Do you think of joy coming from obeying the Ten Commandments? Certainly, disobeying God's commandments separates us from God's love and joy. To review a few, and starting from the bottom up, number 10. Do not covet what your neighbor has. Wanting what someone else has, or coveting, inhibits the joy of what we do have. If we always want something more, then we're never satisfied with what we have. Like this Christmas season, if we want what our brother gets for Christmas, we won't enjoy the gifts we do get. Number 9. Don't lie. We know how much trouble lying gets us into. Deeper and deeper doo-doo. Yes, not telling the truth blocks joy. The same goes for gossiping, saying bad things about someone else. It always ends up making us feel bad. Number 8 is don't steal. The guilt that comes with stealing takes away all the joy of having something if we took it from someone else. We don't just steal things. We steal when we take credit for something that someone else did. When we cheat, even on taxes, and one we sometimes don't think of, we're stealing when we don't give someone the love they deserve because of our righteousness in thinking that we are better than they are. Did you ever think that God gave us these commandments to keep us from wrong because God really wants joy for us? So often these commandments make God seem like he's just striking us down because we've done something wrong. When the reality is, God just wants us to be full of love and joy. And when we do these wrong things, we separate ourselves from God's love and joy. Another important step is to remember joy. Let's think together about when we have felt joy. Can you think of an example? The birth of a child, the birth of a grandchild, sharing a special holiday with your family, coming together on Christmas Eve in the church. So often it is an event we look back on and with that experience of feeling joy. We can store this up for times when we can't feel the joy, even if we know it's there. Life has big hills and valleys. We may be climbing a hill that seems like forever. Or we may be down in a valley that looks like it has no upside to crawl out of. Pull up that memory of joy during these times. It does help to remind us. There's a quote from Pema Chodron on Facebook, and I found it just as I was preparing to work on this sermon. It seemed I was to share it with you, and it is on the back of your bulletin. It didn't print off very good, so I'm reading it. In life, we think that the point is to pass the test or overcome the problem. But the real truth is that things don't really get solved. They come together for a time, then they fall back apart. Then they come together again, and then they fall apart again. It's just like that. Personal discovery and growth come from letting there be room for all of this to happen. Room for grief. Can't even say the word. For relief, for misery, for joy. Suffering comes from wishing things were different. Misery is self-inflicted when we are expecting the ideal to overcome the actual, or needing things or people or places to be different for us so we can then be happy. Let the hard things in life break you. Let them affect you. Let them change you. Let these hard moments inform you. Let this pain be your teacher. The experiences of your life are trying to tell you something about yourself. Don't cop out on that. Don't run away and hide under your covers. Lean into it. What is this lesson in this wind? What is this storm trying to tell you? What will you learn if you face it with courage, with full honesty, and lean into it? We don't want to hear some of this. I know. I don't either. But if we are going to go through these awful things, and we are going to, how sad if we wall ourselves off and don't let them form us and change us. And remember, Jesus tells us, I have told you this so that my joy will be in you. I also want your joy to be complete. One more image to share is, besides having sticky, gluey fingers to catch what sometimes feels like an odd-shaped football of joy, is to have a joy filter. Imagine you have a filter that can filter out what is not so good, the negative thoughts we have, seeing the dark side of something that happens to us. What if tomorrow morning we would wake up, pause a moment, and tell ourselves, today I'm going to wear my joy filter. I'm not going to let others get to me with their negativity. I am not going to see the bad side of people. I am going to intentionally look for the good. Once again, this is what our verses from Scripture tell us to do. And from 1 John we read, Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us and His love is made complete in us. We have a big part to play in disseminating God's love. And it's true, no one has ever seen God. And then there is this big, but if we love one another, God lives in us and His love is made complete in us. And I think this says that without us, God's love cannot be complete. Wow, a bit of responsibility here. So if God's love cannot be made complete, the joy God wants us all to experience cannot be made complete either. We are God's hands and feet and voices sharing God's complete love and utter joy. We have to catch that football to pass it on. We are a vital link. And true love and joy comes from feeling the love and joy in another as our own. We feel the most joy when we bring joy to another, and that's what it's all about. Amen.